So as we stand here, Joe, in beautiful February sunshine, it's the weather we're actually concerned about. Absolutely. But not today, obviously.
No, not today. This video, we're going to be talking about the importance of IP ratings. Now, we went out on a beautiful sunny day like this to Brescia in northern Italy, to the Palazzoli factory.
Yes.
And we had a look at their IP testing laboratory there, and we saw how important it is to prevent the ingress of moisture. So if you've not watched that video, click the link, because that's quite an interesting one. However, in this video, guys, what are we particularly going to be thinking about as we move into a more advanced installation?
Yeah, so we've seen in the past, haven't we, people fitting outside lights, outside socket outlets with an IP rating, and maybe even cutting holes in the bottom of the socket outlets as drain-off points. That's okay, but now we're talking about highly expensive electronic equipment being screwed to the exterior of a building, and ingress of moisture now becomes even more crucial than it's ever been, Joe.
Yeah, absolutely. With the changes to Amendment 1, we can expect to see more and more complicated bits of kit being installed inside our EV charging units, things that are going to be monitoring currents, voltages, all sorts of things. And actually, those items are going to become increasingly sensitive to moisture getting into the circuit and starting to cause problems. So what we want to have a look at in this video is just how do we go about preventing that, because there's one or two unique challenges that come when we're installing EV charge points. And how are we going to look at getting around that, guys?
Yeah, so we're probably going to be bringing either a twin and CPC cable or a steel wire armoured cable into the actual enclosure. Often if it's a steel wire armoured cable, that's going to go into the bottom of the enclosure. Yeah. So straight away, that makes maybe the IP rating a little bit easier to maintain. Yeah. However, in this installation, I can't see a cable, so it's probably coming through the rear.
Yep.
And in order to maintain the IP rating, it's crucial that we reinstate it back to the minimum IP rating of the enclosure in the first place. And that often is tried to be achieved using silicone sealant, Joe. Is that a good idea?
It's not a great idea, because you can't guarantee the IP rating. You may have missed a little bit, may not have bonded correctly in places, and also actually it doesn't look quite as nice and neat as it could do when you open up the enclosure.
So when we open up this enclosure, and we're going to open it using my Wiha Speede screwdriver.
Nice.
I thought, as we've got such a fancy piece of electronics, we'd use a fancy dancy screwdriver in order to get into to get inside there. Again, when we look at the manufacturer's instructions, you'll see they've been so crucial with the IP ratings, they've actually set the torque rating of the screws that hold the front cover on in order that it maintains the IP rating to the seal at the back.
Yeah.
Let's open it up and have a look how they've actually got the cables into this electrical enclosure.
Let's do it.
Okay, Joe, can we just pop off the cover so I can attack it with my Speede screwdriver?
For sure, yeah. Just undo these two little clips at the bottom here and it just peels off like that.
And I'll just whip this one off. And we'll get inside here. The IP rating of this enclosure, Joe, is?
IP65 is what we're aiming for. And of course, it's very important that if we make any holes in this to bring cables and such in, we need to maintain that IP rating.
Okay. And the torque setting when these go back on is a torque setting of 1.2 newton meters of torque. So it's really clever that they've even suggested the torque rating of the actual screws themselves.
Yeah, because you could over tighten it potentially and actually damage the seal rather than under tightening it and not using the seal. Just remove that ribbon connection there, and that is now ready for us to have a look at the inside.
After all the fun of opening it up, I've got a massive issue, Joe. Look, someone's put the glands on the wrong way round.
Well, it's interesting, isn't it? But this kind of flies in the face of perhaps your entire lifetime of electrical training when you look at this. You've always put the body of the gland on the outside. But what's wrong with that, guys?
Absolutely nothing.
Absolutely nothing. You know, you've got the same principle going on. You've got that there for the cable retention. You've got it there to prevent the ingress of moisture. Actually putting the body of the gland on the inside and the lock nut on the outside, all that does is just put the bulkiness of this inside, and in this fitting there's plenty of room to do that, and it also means that we've not had to chisel away at the back of the wall to fit the gland in, then tighten it up, then push it back and fit the thing on the wall. We've also not had to flood this with silicone. It's just, I think that's a really, it's lateral thinking, but I think it works really well.
It does, but there is one other key element to this. In both cases, there is an O-ring or seal that must be present, whether that be on the inside or the outside. So as you look at these two here, you got your one, Joe?
I've got my one there. So you see there, you've got the seal there, which again, without that, that actually doesn't have an IP, well, in this case, it's IP68. We've got to at least match the IP65 of the fitting.
Yes.
But if you don't have that on there, you lose the IP rating of the gland. It's not just about that bit, it's also about that bit as well.
So, simple solution, to what could be a major problem if a cable just come through and we flooded it with silicone, with all this electronic components in here, ingress of moisture in there would do that no favours whatsoever, and we're talking several hundred pounds of electronics screwed to the outside of your installation. Simple Absolutely. Solution, Joe.
Yeah, and the internals of these are not going to get any simpler as time goes on. In fact, they're likely to get more complicated, so we've got to maintain those IP ratings. There's one or two other clever things that this particular manufacturer, Myenergi, have done. They've installed little bungs in the back there to make sure that no moisture can get back in the pre-existing drilling and fixing holes that aren't being used. There's little washers here with little rubber seals around the back of them, so when you screw that on, that creates a seal around the fixing holes as well.
And the seal around the edge is also fixed. It isn't one of them ones you're sort of wrestling it back into position.
So it makes sense, doesn't it? If the manufacturer has gone to all this trouble of making sure that all these points of entry for moisture have been dealt with and sealed up, it would be devastating for us not to do our part by maintaining the IP rating of the fitting where we punch holes in it.
So Joe, all it remains now is to put the cover back on, reattach our ribbon cable here to our front board, and then return the torque settings to these screws, as I said previously, to 1.2 newton meters of torque in order that this seal here completes the IP rating of this electrical enclosure.
For sure, let's do it. I'll do the technical bit.
Oh yeah, there you go.
Oh, years of training, look.
Right person, right job.
Right, let's get these screwed up. So that's set to 1.2?
Yeah, 1.2 newton meters of torque.
Nice.
Okay, and we can see the process. We just nip them round and then cover goes back on.
I always think it's worth noting at this point there's a temptation sometimes to do these up with a normal screwdriver and then finish them with a torque screwdriver. But with 1.2 newton meters, sorry, if you don't want to go above that value, if you do it up with a normal screwdriver, chances are you're going to go beyond that.
Yeah.
And then when you come to tighten that in, it clicks, you go, oh, that's nicely at 1.2. You could be at like 2.4, couldn't you?
You could.
And just not realise. So the idea is do it up completely with the torque screwdriver, and then you've got it at the right setting. Should we do that last
one? Yeah. Well,
after we've gone through all this trouble.
Just in the top corner, probably the worst place not to have it done. Haven't it? Okay, yeah, so they're all done. You need two of you to do it, obviously, because one of you is going to miss one of the screws out. Replace the front cover as well, Joe.
Absolutely. Let's volley that back on. There we go.
IP rating of the enclosures back to it. And again, simple trick of using a gland. Okay, like this. Put it in reverse, making sure we've got an O-ring to make sure the IP rating is correct as it goes within the enclosure.
Yep.
Do you consider things like this make electricians' life easier, Joe?
Absolutely, very much so, and we like stuff like that. It's worth noting at this point, the regulations contain specific requirements for the IP rating of enclosures for EV charging units. I believe the value is IP44.
It is.
However, you need to be working to the manufacturer's tolerances. If they go above that, if they say it's IP65, you've got to match the IP rating that they specify as well in order to maintain your warranty and the long-term guaranteed functioning of that piece of equipment.